All right, Sam, let's get into this wide receiver class. I think the debate at the top is generally Jerry Jeudy, the wide receiver from Alabama, and then CeeDee Lamb, the wide receiver from Oklahoma. Currently, Mike Renner, our draft guy now, has CeeDee Lamb over Jerry Jeudy at 5 and 6. Again, one of those things where it's like, he even said on Twitter, it's debatable, changes all the time. Do you have a preference between Jerry Jeudy and CeeDee Lamb from what we saw on the film grinding yesterday?
Yes.
Who do you like?
Jerry Jeudy.
Why?
Because he has the best route running skills of anybody I've ever seen come out of college.
Ever seen come out of college?
I think so.
Can you remember what Antonio Brown looked like? Remember you?
Yeah.
You said, "Hey, this was weird," and you evaluated, and you're like, "Ah, this will never play."
Yeah.
Is it anything like that, or was that just like a different animal when Antonio Brown came?
It was a different type of thing because he did everything slower. Like Antonio Brown had this weird thing where he was able to make these sort of sidesteps and moves to get around people, and it just didn't look like it should function, and it did. And I was like, that there's no way that works against superior athletes. Like, it's one thing for, where is he, Central Michigan?
Yeah.
But that's not going to happen against, you know, NFL players. It turns out it did. But Jeudy does the same kind of thing, just faster. Like, my analysis of him was Jerry Jeudy is essentially if you ran Calvin Ridley at, like, 120% speed.
Like, that's pretty good.
And I loved Ridley coming out. I thought he was a clear first-round player. And the reason was his route running is exactly the same thing. His route running was so good that he was able to get himself, his understanding of how to set up defenders, how to get open, how to break away from leverage, all this stuff was phenomenal. So he would generate more separation than anybody else in that draft class. Now, his hands weren't that great, but the separation was important because it bought him extra room to sort of, you know, not catch it cleanly, juggle it, double catch, that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Jeudy's hands, I think, are better than Ridley's, and his route running is better and faster. Like, he does all the things Ridley did, and he does them faster and, like, at a more dangerous and athletic level. The number of plays where you just put it on, and the poor cornerback trying to live with his release or his moves after he gets into his route, and are just, they can't deal with it. It's too good.
In his, Jeudy's pure speed is probably in the 4.3 range. I mean, just pure speed is fast.
Yeah.
I mean, is high, is good, right? And then, usually when you have a, because we'll talk about his teammate Henry Ruggs in a minute, who might be sub 4.3, and his speed is just electric and ridiculous. But Ruggs isn't the same type of route runner. He doesn't, usually if you're that fast, it's tough to slow down, meaning it's tough to be quick, right? The fact that Jeudy has that type of quickness and speed is just a little ridiculous.
He's also, His run after the catch stuff is kind of nuts as well, because the quickness that he has in his route running translates exactly to stupid moves after the catch where he just makes people fall over without touching them.
Right.
Like his ability to cut and just string together basically back-to-back cuts, you know, cut to the right, then cut to the left, and the guy in front of him is shot off in the wrong direction. He just takes off into space is insane. He has this weird ability to sink to get low, sink, and basically cut back to back. Kind of the way, you know, Marshawn Lynch always looked, even when he was running in a straight line, always looked like he was heading, every step was sideways. Yeah. Jeudy kind of does that as well with these sort of back to back cuts.
Oh, so he's Marshawn Lynch?
No. And it just leaves people grasping at air. He's incredible after the catch. He's incredible in his route running. He might not be the best contested catch guy or, you know, going to traffic that much, but he is going to get you more separation than anybody else in this draft class on a consistent basis.
So no worries about that. As I'm watching the film, I'm like, yeah, you know, the dig route, you know, that middle of the field stuff. I don't know that he's a high volume, you know, catch 110 passes and a bunch of them, like a Michael Thomas type, which is fine. I mean, he's a different type of receiver. So, are you okay with that?
Yeah, he's probably not going to get those sort of, you know, high point contested catch and traffic type of passes. But given how much he gets open, it just, who cares? Like, maybe, like, if he did that as well, he might be one of the greatest of all time, but
yeah,
he doesn't,
yeah.
So he's just really good. Like, there was a play There was a play I drew up as a GIF and posted on Twitter where it was just a simple sort of out route, right? And he basically tied the defensive back so badly in knots that when he broke outside, it was like 5-7, maybe more yards of clear separation. Like if that's 3rd and 5, he's generated the kind of separation that means you or I could get a first down, let alone an NFL quarterback. And he can do that consistently every single down. That is huge because, like, it doesn't, at that point, you're eliminating a huge number of the plays where he needs to make a contested catch because he's wide the hell open.
No, I get it. So route running is spectacular. The speed plus quickness is fantastic. And there's a few guys in this class that are similar. CD Lamb, when watching him, I thought the biggest thing that stood out to me was the feel. So there's different types of receivers, different ways of creating yards after the catch, right? Like a lot of people think of like Wes Welker back in the day being super shifty and making guys miss. You know, you've got George Kittle, he uses speed and power. To me, Judy is like shiftiness. He's going to juke a guy and he's going to fall over. CD Lamb has this great feel for where defenders are and just running away from them. Just essentially using their leverage against them, working away from their leverage, catching that 5-yard hitch and taking it to the house, like, or almost to the house like he did against Baylor, because he knows where defenders are and he's got just a great feel for that and vision after the catch as well. I think that's where Lamb separates himself from other guys in this class, after the catch, with the way he works that.
Yeah, he's a strange guy to watch because he's got a weird body type for a start. He's like all trunk.
Trunk guy.
Yeah. And then
trunk, your legs. We were joking yesterday, right? That size.
It never looks like he's moving very fast, but he appears to be, you know, in the way that he runs past people, runs through all this kind of stuff. And then also, like, he doesn't look like the most powerful guy in the world, but guys just skittle off him all the time when it
all
comes
the
to
time.
Tackling.
Yeah.
So he's...
And we're trying to figure out, is that just the Big 12 or is that there's something... Like, honestly, like, defenders fall off to Deshaun Watson quite a bit, and he's not the biggest guy, but he looks like Big Ben sometimes, the way he shrugs off tacklers, and Lamb has some of that.
It might be like the Antonio Brown thing, right, where you kind of look at it and you go, I mean, it doesn't look that impressive, but it's working, and it works all the time, so there's probably something to it.
Right.
I think that's kind of where I am with CD Lamb, is that a lot of the times it doesn't look as spectacular as Jerry Jeudy, but it functions, it works as well. Now, there's a huge problem with evaluating Big 12 receivers because, like, the first couple of targets we pulled up, like, literally nobody was covering him. Like,
he just runs total, wide open through his zone for a 60-yard touchdown.
Total coverage bust. Nobody's picking that up. He just runs into the secondary, and he's 20 yards ahead of anybody else.
And that's where the grades will pick it up. Like, here's this 60-yard touchdown, and it's like, okay, we might just give you a positive, but like a low expected positive type of thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, I was saying that as soon as there is a high quality draft prospect at receiver in the Big 12, they should be forced to immediately transfer to the SEC or another conference is actually going to play some defense.
I like it.
Because it is miserable trying to like weed out all of the targets that are just meaningless because they're busts. Nobody's covering them. Like the coverage is insane. And the guy just wanders through for a wide open touchdown. And there's a bunch of these as well where it's like a 5-second, 20-yard dig route, you know, into the gap, the giant hole that's opened up between the secondary that's been run off and the linebackers that are all doing something underneath. There's now like a 20-yard gap of open space in the middle, but it's going to take 5 seconds for him to get there. Again, these are just like meaningless snaps that it's almost impossible to do anything with.
Right.
And there's so many of those for him, but it's difficult to find a hole in his game in terms of what he doesn't do well because he appears to do everything well.
Does Lamb look fast to you?
Like I say, he doesn't look it, but he appears to run away from a lot of people. So I'm going to assume that he is faster than he looks.
Yeah, I know I'm repeating, but it's just like I was back and forth on it too.
I kept sort of wanting to say it was a smooth style, but I don't think it's even that. It just there's something about it that it doesn't look fast, but I think it probably is. There's just something weird about the way it happens.
I've seen the acceleration. You know, a lot of guys. Yeah. It's kind of like the quarterback who doesn't always throw lasers. He throws a catchable ball. I feel like a big part of Lamb's route running is just like doing just enough, what he thinks he needs to do to get open. But sometimes when he needs to run away from a guy, like you said, he will. Other guys that are... So we watched Henry Ruggs, as I said, and Jalen Reagor from TCU. Both guys similar to these other guys. They're more speed type receivers. Henry Ruggs, you know, they say he's got sub-4.3 speed. That kind of shows up.
Yeah,
on the field as well. I thought he looked a lot like a Will Fuller or a Mike Wallace, a guy that is going to translate to the NFL as a legitimate, you know, the old take the top off the defense type of guy, a guy that you just want on the field because corners and safeties have to respect his deep speed. They for do. Ruggs.
Yeah, his. I mean, he's got speed there. Yeah, definitely shows up. I like Mike Wallace as the comp for him. This was sort of white Mike Wallace before he went, you know, off a cliff and didn't look like the same guy again.
He was a legitimate deep threat for the Steelers and a little bit the Dolphins.
Yeah, but Pittsburgh, the Steelers. Pittsburgh Mike Wallace, I think, is a good comparison for Ruggs, where it's like he is so fast in a straight line that if you don't disrupt it, if you don't get in its way, he's going by you because you can't live with that. And he's got that kind of thing where, if he gets the ball in his hands in the open field and there's enough of a space to get moving, he's gone. You're not catching him. So yeah, I think so that was a good comp.
He had, so among draft eligible receivers, this is on our rankings list over at PFF.com, Ruggs has the second highest yards after the catch per reception of anybody in the class, right ahead of CeeDee Lamb, right behind Ayuk from Arizona State, who you want to discuss as well. But he's number two in yards after the catch per reception. But he just really does it by running away from guys. I don't think he's the most shifty.
No.
I don't know if it's about the body, you know, the feel and the vision that like a CeeDee Lamb has. It's just like he's faster than everybody.
Yeah.
And if he gets in the open field, it's going to, instead of being a 20-yard gain, it's 50. I mean, he's going to take it to the house with that speed.
Yeah, there were a couple of plays where he, you know, made a catch over the middle and there was just enough of a window. And you just see him accelerate through a gap that most people wouldn't make it through.
Right.
And instead of getting, you know, a 20, 30-yard catch, he takes it 60 to the house because he's just faster than the guy who's trying to close close the angle on it.
What about Jalen Reagor from TCU? Another guy listed at 5'11", but he was on Bruce Feldman's freaks list, I believe. Another guy that runs in the 4.3s, supposedly 4.32 is what he ran at TCU. But he's another guy that's quick as well. Like, he's really quick in and out of breaks, and he maintains speed out of breaks, and he's pretty good getting off press.
Yeah, I really liked him a lot. Strong hands as well. There were a bunch of catches he made that were not the best placed passes in the world, but he like took them away from defensive backs.
Some horrible
quarterback
play.
So he's a guy who gets completely screwed by the quarterback throwing him the ball. Like the number of passes where he's wide open and the ball just doesn't go anywhere near him. I pulled up a pass to you where it was like a quick bubble screen. The ball's in the dirt, like 7 yards in front of him.
It was
like,
great.
You would have put the ball significantly closer to him.
I could throw a mean bubble screen.
Than that guy did.
They're not as easy as they look. You know, angles and stuff like that. But I could throw a good bubble screen.
Both of you and me would have got the ball significantly closer to him.
And my passing yards would have been great because he would have picked something up after the catch.
Right.
So he's another guy. I really think Judy and Lamb are in a different world as far as after the catchability. Because of various things. They're just so good at it. I don't know if Rager's the best. And Renner had in his notes coming into the season that he's outstanding after the catch. I think he had fewer reps this year that kind of showed that off. I don't know if he's got the same feel as some of those other guys with the ball in his hands. Who are you arguing on Twitter?
Yeah, Patriots fans that think Gilmore should be higher in the 101.
No. So why should he not be?
Why should he not? Well, they're just saying, oh, so Gilmore. So you have Sherman above Gilmore. It's like, well, yeah. We do. Greatest hire, but also all of the numbers were better as well. Now,
Gilmore played a more challenging role as far as covering
things.
But that, role doesn't matter. Like, the thing, he really got torched against Devontae Parker in the last game of the season.
Uh-huh.
And he also had a few plays, forget the numbers, like where he's given up separation and there's an overthrow, an underthrow, whatever it is. And all those things show up, not in the numbers, but they do show up in the grades. So that's that explanation.
They do. But the numbers dramatically favor Sherman. Like his passer rating against is better. He allowed like a third of the yardage, like half the catches. He went something like eight snaps in coverage between receptions allowed more than Gilmore, like five per target more. Like his numbers across the board were dramatically better than Gilmore's. Now you can definitely argue that Gilmore had a tougher role and that should bump him up. But again, like how much do you weigh those things?
All right, let's wrap up a little bit more of the wide receiver discussion. We watched a little T. Higgins from Clemson, 6'4", 215, and you and I both looked at each other and just said, catch radius. That's in Renner's notes, catch radius. I mean, that seems like the biggest thing that stands out on his film.
And isn't that always the most concerning?
So the concerning thing that you say is more about contested catches. This is a little different. This is more like an Allen. Look. So Allen Robinson has some real good wiggle to his route running.
Yeah.
And I think that's why Allen Robinson is a, you know, top 10 caliber receiver, right? He can get open and his contested catchability is just next level type of stuff. I think Higgins has that next level contested catchability that's in Robinson's range. But to maximize your value, you also need to get open. I think Higgins has, he's kind of in between like the big dudes who can't separate, and then an Allen Robinson who every now and again runs some routes like he's 5'10" and shifty. Is that fair?
Yeah. I just maintain that if the thing you lead with for a receiver is contested catch radius, I think it's a bad sign. Now, I think Higgins has got some skills. He's got the ability to get open. He can, you know, he can make some things happen after the catch.
Yeah, 12 broken tackles on 59 catches.
I think he's more of a well-rounded receiver than anything else. Like, he seems to be pretty good at everything.
But his biggest strength is traffic.
Yeah, probably. Certainly compared to these other guys. I mean, he's the first guy on this list, I think, that he's the best of the ones we've mentioned at that.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. I mean, we were going there, and this is the interesting thing about this wide receiver class is you've got some incredible speed. You have a big guy like T. Higgins. You have a guy like Laviska Shenault from Colorado. I don't know how much you've seen of him, but he's essentially like our comparison in the draft guide is Cordero Patterson. And it's not, and again, take comparisons for what they are, which is usually just like a snippet of a guy's game. But he's like Cordero Patterson because Patterson is like a running back. And the Patriots actually used him as a running back. Shenault has been an offensive weapon at Colorado. You get the ball to him in the flat. He's incredible after the catch. He probably could straight up play running back for a team if you wanted him to. And then he's a decent receiver as well. Like the way he goes up and catches the ball. And he's a potential sub 4.4 guy as well with a pretty big frame.
Yeah.
Who else did you take a liking to or take a look at?
I liked Ayuk.
Yeah?
Yeah. He was interesting because obviously he's coming out of Arizona State a year after N'Keal Harry. And are they the same year, right? They were both juniors at the same time. Like Ayuk stayed
Sounds
for
right.
a senior season and N'Keal Harry came out. He is a dramatically better player than N'Keal Harry is. Now, I think they have some strength in the same area. Like they're both really good after the catch. But where they differ is that I think it's easier to get the ball in Ayuk's hands than it is Harry because he's going to generate separation on his own without you having to manufacture him all these targets the same way you would have to with Harry. So Harry's thing is you did need, like you led off with contested catch guy, right? Incredible body control, contested catches, wins all the jump balls, and he's really good after the catch. The end. Won't separate.
Yeah.
Problem. Ayuk will separate. He can make real good plays after the catch. He won't. I don't think he's as good a contested catch guy as N'Keal Harry is. But as I say, you're going to have a lot less contested catches because he'll get open. So, yeah, I liked what he brought. I think, you know, given that one guy came out a year ago and this is what Ayuk did, taking over the mantle this year, I think he's a dramatically better prospect.
All right, go check out PFF.com. We've got all of our draft position rankings as of right now. Mike Renner's doing a great job. The 2-for-1 Drafts podcast. They speak draft all year.
Talk
draft
and rookies.
All. They're what?
And rookies. Hence 2-for-1.
Draft and rookies. Do you want to have Mike on the show? You hate having guests.
We'll
just squeeze him right in the middle. Just give the kid 10 minutes. Little Mike, he's just trying to make a name for himself. As like the next. I mean, I was the draft guy for a few years. Mike's trying to work his way up.
The other guy we should probably mention is Denzel Mims.
Oh, yeah.
From Baylor.
And Michael Pittman Jr. But
well, Mims in particular, because you know why?
I don't know why.
Stand out at the Senior Bowl.
Oh, jeez.
Do you not know how I enter the draft process?
Well, I was going to throw KJ Hill in there as the sleeper because
so
he
another
was
guy,
the Senior
yeah.
Bowl.
But Denzel Mims had the highest grade of any receiver during the one-on-ones in the Senior Bowl.
Is he your number one?
I wouldn't go that far yet. I mean,
oh, okay, yeah.
Judy is phenomenal, but. Denzel Mims was absolutely beasting people at the Senior Bowl. And, you know, some guy was complaining on Twitter because he skyrocketed up our draft board from, like, before to after, right? And they're like, how can you have all this grading on a guy and then change him by, like, 30 spots in your big board based off 1 week? Like, well, so, A, 1 week of practice at an all-star game is really important in and of itself, right? That's a significant amount of data that exists completely new from anything else, right?
Yeah.
It is a completely different environment that you don't get to see at any other time and evaluate these people. Two, for a guy like Mims in particular, it's huge because he comes from that Baylor offense that runs like three routes, right? So now you get him to the Senior Bowl and you say, all right, you now have to run a legitimate route tree. How are you going to do? Now, that was, you know, one of the big concerns with Corey Coleman a few years ago. It's like the guy comes from Baylor. He runs three routes. How does he run an NFL route tree?
It's a different offense there, but a similar issue because they still ran a limited route tree there.
Limited route tree. And it's like, how does that translate when you suddenly need him to run a whole bunch more stuff and more complex things? So for Mims to go to that and have to run a much bigger variety of things and still crush everybody, that's really impressive. And that is a completely different set of information that you then apply.
I mean, the other issue is you responded to one guy that questioned the address.
Wasn't one, or a few people.
Okay. Just a little insight on that, too, because there was a whole thing about Todd McShay not having Josh Jones from Houston, you know, not even in like his top 220 or something going into the Senior Bowl. And, you know, we have him as a first rounder and all that stuff. And, you know, Todd McShay, he's got other jobs to do for ESPN now. He's like a sideline reporter, you know, so a lot of, you know, the fans, I know these guys are considered draft gurus and that's their job and all that, but they're not really always doing it all the way, you know, all year round. And sometimes you just didn't get, you know, to evaluate that guy. I'm just defending Todd a little bit on the Josh Jones thing. And even a guy like Mims, there's a million different receivers. A lot of these guys are going to be interchangeable in 8 through 15. So there can certainly be some movement there. Michael Pittman is the other guy, and Juwan Jennings that round out the top 10 so far. 6'4", 6'3", both guys physical. Jennings has been high point in passes seemingly for the last 6 years in the SEC. And then Pittman, one of the best drop rates in the NFL. Another more of a possession type of guy. Big, physical Michael Pittman Jr.
Son of the running back?
I believe so.
Are his biceps so large that he can't carry the ball properly?
Yeah, that was famous. I don't know if it was famous. I remember saying it with all my college buddies all the time. They'd be like, John Gruden said, Michael Pittman has one hell of a bicep muscle. Mm. That's how he described it.
Well, that was it. Yeah, his thing was people used to say that his biceps were so big that he couldn't properly carry the football.
Because you can't get that 4 points of contact.
They were messing up the 5 points of contact. One of them was not where it should be because of the bicep pushing the ball out of the way.
He'd never play for Mariucci.
You want to get rid of me and get back to more great PFF YouTube content? All you have to do is push that button right there and subscribe. Thanks for watching.